Begin. Kalki, who's a fantastic actor, I've had the opportunity of working on stage with her, dancing with her, doing the tango with her on stage. Fantastic dancer, Kalki.
Oh, so are you, Purab. I wouldn't have been able to do it without the other half.
So tell us, what does United by Half mean? I mean, you're a big part of this campaign.
I am indeed. For me, it's a really important campaign because, well, you know, UCB is such a huge brand, and I think that when a big brand like this comes on board for women empowerment, it means that women empowerment is becoming a commercial issue, an issue which everyone cares about. And I think, well, they're pretty smart to be doing this because, you know, I think that things are changing in a big way. And actually, equality for women and equality in general will make society a better place. It's not just benefiting women, it's also benefiting the rest of society and saying that, you know, in order to uplift society, we need to use the other half of the society and reward them. And, you know, it helps for an economy, it helps to alleviate some of the stresses that we have, especially as couples living in a modern context. So, yeah, I'm greatly happy.
It's only way forward. You know, it's only way to progress forward, I would think. But anyway, we are going to sit down now. We're going to make ourselves comfortable because we're inviting two more panelists onto stage.
We need some more women on the
stage. We need some more women on the stage, correct, to make it half-half. Anyway, so I'm going to call two more very beautiful women onto stage. We're going to start with a good friend of mine, Gul Panag. Can we have Gul on stage, please? We're going to quickly talk to you, but before talking to you, we're going to get somebody else also onto stage. Meghna Bhatt, who's the Chief Strategy Officer of Scoop Whoop. Can we have you on stage too, please, Meghna? Now, I would like to put a formal complaint to Sandeep Chug and to Benetton that we are not half right now. But anyway, we have three lovely ladies. Ladies, can we have you seated? Sandeep, can we have you seated too?
Yeah, sure. So maybe.
I don't know, Purab, I think you need to count the audience also.
I can't see, the lights are very bright. I can't see anybody actually.
Oh, yeah, oh my, look at this. Segregation is not a good thing. I think that we must interact.
I'll sit in the, come on.
Yeah, come. With my pink
with your pink orange bag. I was complaining that
two girls have like
correct.
Bright
I was complaining bags. In the beginning backstage that both these beautiful women have their United by Half t-shirts on and their red bags. And all three, my God, there's even Meghna there joined them. And me and Sandeep are really.
Sandeep's hiding.
No, I'm still under
we need to accessorize you guys.
Still under Delhi weather.
But now you're in Bombay. Mumbai. Sorry.
We need our red bags. Do you need red bags for men?
Of course.
All right, okay, we're going to get a little serious now and we're going to do a little bit of a panel discussion where I'm going to just keep quiet and take opinions of all these wonderful people we have on stage with us. So, women empowerment, though such a powerful topic, gets used very loosely in today's time, where everyone talks about the subject without even understanding the true crux of the term. Well, the aim is to reach out to women and men from modern families to stand up against stereotypes and take a pledge to claim and give their partners their deserving share in a relationship and society. The issue being very close to Benetton, the brand has been promoting it through its women empowerment programs, five key efforts, sustainable livelihood, non-discrimination, and equal opportunities, access to health, quality education, and the end of every form of violence against women around the world. Well, in the world we live today, do you think that we are justifying the term women's empowerment? Meghna, let's start with you.
Justifying as in we definitely don't have equality for women, right?
Still in our country, not or anywhere in the world.
Anywhere in the world. I mean, you know, we always say women's rights is really about human rights, right? And if you look at, if you just go through the list of human rights and you kind of compare that with what women, what rights women have, you'll find there's a huge disparity. A simple example, and you, you know, it's not confined to rural areas or certain areas of the world. It's across all spectrum, all strata of society. A simple example, you know, women in India after marriage, I know so many women who have to take permission from their in-laws to go and visit their own parents after marriage, which is a basic violation, you know, violation of a fundamental right to freedom of movement, which is a basic human right, right? So the disparities are huge, and there's a lot of work that all of us have to do, men and women together, to kind of create that equal society that we all aim for.
So would be Gul, what do you? More questions are coming to my mind from what you said, but I'll reserve, stay back. Gul, what do you feel about this?
I don't think it's possible to disagree with anything that Meghna said, because we do live in a society that's very, very unequal, and I think two additional factors in the Indian society actually make it a further, perhaps deadlier cocktail than anywhere else. And one is that patriarchy in the Indian society is all pervasive. It's perpetuated largely by the female half of the population as well, which is what makes it even more dangerous. Because the best way of ensuring something goes on forever is if you get the victims themselves to propagate it. So we are extremely patriarchal, and in fact, preference for male children is still at an all-time high in I would say more than 80% of India. A lot of us sitting here may not agree with that thought, but that's not the reality of India. The second thing is, I don't think we've actually had a women's rights movement, or, you know, in Meghna's words, a uniform human rights movement, or a civil rights movement for that matter. In the West, for instance, in the UK and in the US, you had a suffragist movement where women actually had to fight for the right to political equality and fight for the right to vote. They were actually beaten to ask for the right to vote. Now, we never had that sort of a movement in India. And therefore, at some level, a lot of the liberties that we have theoretically, which are namely theoretical equality in terms of access to opportunity legally, socially, politically, economically, access to healthcare and education, were just sort of handed to us on a platter. And because we, to some extent, didn't fight for them, we don't end up enforcing them. In fact, the inheritance laws were amended about a couple years ago to make sure that the girl child also has an equal right to ancestral property. But that's again a right that's not enforced, because it was not a right that women fought for. There were a few women that fought for it. Of course, they filed petitions, and therefore the law was revised. But as such, there hasn't been a mass outpouring of women together to fight for their rightful place, which means accepting that we are different from men and that we have our own special skill set physiologically, but also that we deserve equality in the eyes of law. And I think that fight hasn't happened, which is probably why we're still lagging in inequality.
Lots of women getting together. So, Kalki, do you want to add something to that? And also, yeah. I mean, just picking up from what both of them said, that we're talking about women empowerment. I mean, the sense I'm getting, and also something I strongly feel, that women themselves have to get that empowerment within themselves and feel empowered to come out.
Just picking up from what Gul was saying is that, you know, this idea that women need to be seen as equal in the eyes of the law, I think one of the big problems we have is that we have religious law, right, for different religious groups. So a woman who's Muslim will have different rights of divorce than, you know, a woman who's secular, and this allows for a huge amount of unfairness that is seen very often in our society. You know, you have your neighbor who's not getting the same rights as you are, even though you're both women. So I think the idea of a uniform civil code is very, very important, and will take things a lot further. And what were you just saying now?
I'm talking about a woman feeling empowered enough to go out there and say that I deserve an equal space, you know?
Sorry. I think the psyche right now of women is still under a lot of fear, you know? The kind of violence that we see towards women keeps us afraid. And so, for example, if you are having a fight at 3 a.m, you're not going to step out of your house. A man might, you know? And that really, that literally, physically keeping yourself indoors, because of fear that is perpetuated by media, by you know, the society, and is really, really strong and prevalent here. And I think it's really important that we consciously, as women, step out of our way to break those barriers. So there's something called Why Loiter, which is run by a friend of mine. It's like women taking public spaces, going out at 10 o'clock at night to a park in a group and hanging out. You know, we see men hanging out, smoking a cigarette outside, but we never see a bunch of women doing that. So reclaiming public spaces, making an effort. I'm not saying go out and put yourself in danger 3 in the morning, walk on your own or whatever, but find ways to find that confidence again. You know, come together as women, do things as groups of women, you know, build up the sisterhood, all that stuff.
I love Why Loiter. Kalki introduced it to me a few years ago,
yes.
And it's a really fantastic concept. Moving on to you, Sandeep, tell us about what do you feel? I mean, I know Benetton has this whole campaign going on, but personally, I mean, with your upbringing and your just seeing women in India.
Personally, you know, I will, hello. Yeah, so I will actually take on from what Kalki said when she was addressing you. You know, for a country's growth, we always talk about, you know, the country has to grow, this is a GDP and all. The most important thing is if the women is empowered, you know, you'll see a significant contribution coming towards country growth on an automatic basis. My personal experience, I've been very lucky and privileged that the family in which I've been born and brought up was always, I could see the women being empowered. And right from my grandmother, who had to move along with my dad and other kids at the time of partition partition time from Pakistan to India now. So I could see a family evolution which was much better where the women were empowered as compared to my, you know, relatives and, you know, society around, where I could see a big gap where the women were not empowered. So I've been right from my childhood, my sister, my wife, my mother, I've seen, because they were empowered during the journey of life, I see the family evolution is much, much better as compared to, you know, where you see women are not empowered. So for me, it's something which is very close to my heart. It's something which I see on a daily basis. And that one is, I'm working for this brand, so I want to contribute towards that. But as a citizen of this country, I feel, you know, this is the best way to actually help country grow. If you work on women empowerment and if you make it happen in the right way, you know, you may invest here, you may get foreign institutional investment, everything can happen. But if this section of population is not empowered, you know, all those things would not add the kind of dimension which this element can add. That's how I look at it.
Oh, okay. So, I mean, just talking about workspaces now, I mean, three of us have worked in a common workspace, and we see how many women sometimes are present, and hats off to many of you who have to do scenes in the presence of so many men around in the workspaces that we work. Gul, you and me have been part of two films ourselves. Meghna, what about a corporate space? You being a woman and at Scoop Whoop, I mean, I'm thinking Scoop Whoop is still quite progressive, but if you have spent some time in any other corporate space.
So I've actually been, I mean, Scoop Whoop, like you said, you know, we are, you know, our point of view has always been to not just be mindful of these things, but
let me point out, I don't think I've ever met a man from Scoop Whoop. I'm not only the women.
It's highly
male-dominated. Yes, 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 it is. Yeah, actually, we actually do have a half-half. So half our editors are women
and
half are men. So, yeah, so, and you know, we actively champion the cause. So we're not just mindful. We're champions of you know, equal rights across groups, women, LGBT, etc., etc. So that way, I mean, you know, that's I'm privileged to work in a place like that. But also, I have been, in a sense, lucky, and also, I guess, sort of created that space. You know, since I've been working in media and advertising and all of that, there is it's a different kind of culture there, right? So while a lot of the daily sexism that happens in corporates does exist, we do get the benefit, I guess, of being a more sort of open workspaces than very, very corporatized environments. And, you know, so I think that way I have been lucky because I've worked in those industries. But I see it every day in other work spaces, you know, where the gender pay gap is very real. There is
the pay gap.
Yes,
also.
The wage gap is very real. Also, because, you know, what happens is that women, what, you know, it comes from how you value yourself, right? So you don't tend to be as great negotiators as men when it comes to pay. And that is something that we've seen across, you know, not
again,
just India.
Coming back to the point about a woman feeling deserving enough herself, does she feel deserving? I can't ask for so much.
Yes.
It's a man's sort of privilege.
I don't think it's a man's thing that comes into your head, but it's just how
it's
you value yourself.
I think it's your conditioning. And ultimately, sorry to interrupt, but I completely agree with what Meghna is saying. I think at a large level, our social conditioning, our cultural conditioning from a very young age limits our potential in terms of what we think of what is possible. So it starts right in around class 8-9, beta arts loge ke science loge, girl no take arts or commerce. It's that conditioning as to why would you take not take science, because you can't do science? No, I don't think that's correct. And if there is a two-wheeler that has to be bought, the boy will get the gear wala and the girl will get the non-gear. I mean, once you're riding a bike, you know you're a rider. Kalki is a big
riders,
ass rider.
All three riders.
Once you're riding and the two wheels are in momentum, it's about balance. It's not about changing gears. But these small stereotypical conditionings from a very early age allow you to undervalue yourself, because you feel maybe main itni kabil hu, bas this much only I can do, this much. And probably that's what.
And actually, it starts even younger. Look at preschoolers. Look at the kind of when you go to give gifts to young children. You know, typically you go to a gift shop, you'll see the kind of gifts that they recommend you give a girl child as opposed to what you give a boy child. You know, I've had people, I have a two-year-old daughter, and I've had guys in the gift shop tell me, nahin, ye drilling kit to boys ke liye hai, aur, to aapko cooking set chahiye. So I'm like, no, I don't want
it. It's very interesting because, you know, so I was in the airport just about a week, 10 days ago, and I was I stopped to buy my niece and my nephew a gift, and I asked 5-year-old girl, and he straight away took me to the cookery sort of section, and he said, sir, cooking set.
And we'll be all pink.
So I said, she's not that kind of 5-year-old girl. She needs rollerblades or something. Can I get one of those things? Kalki, we'll move on to you. Are you Indian, French? I mean, because you're born here, I think you may have.
When I figure it out, I'll let you know.
Okay,
Long live identity crisis.
I think she's definitely a French-looking girl with an Indian heart.
I'm fully Indian, but I'm obviously fully French. I keep saying my skin is white, my heart is brown. I'm born here, brought up here, all my life I've been here, but of course I've also had like a lot of.
So we can safely call you reverse coconut.
Yes. That's perfect. I like it.
So tell us, what was it like I don't know if that's really a racist sort of remark, but being a white-skinned girl in growing up in India and a woman also.
Yeah,
was it like? Any experiences?
I really was this odd kid because I had really blonde hair as a kid and white. And I was in a small village called Periyamudalya Chavadi. So everyone.
Even I can't say that.
South Indian proper, for me it was. I think as a very young child, I don't remember being discriminated by the other kids. I think it was more the adults and how adults looked at you and separated you. And of course, with puberty and everything, you being the white girl, I was, when my friends and I would go to Kovalam Beach or, one of these hippie areas, it was always me who got asked for the drugs or, hit on by the guy, because I was, seen as that Baywatch ladki or whatever. They have a reference of what a white girl should be like. So I had to, and then I would like give it back,
in Tamil.
And they would be like, yopa. Then they would get even more excited, which was not good. I had to fight my way through that stereotype. But I think even whatever your skin color, just being a girl, the gaze is so strong in India, the male gaze. You're constantly thinking about how you're stepping out. When I go to New York in the summer, I don't need to wear a bra. And it's such a liberating feeling, And here, you won't even think of it. You limit yourself all the time because, I'm going to Lucknow. Okay, I'm going to take my salwar, So we have to limit ourselves because of things. But, in a way, I also think you have to consciously make an effort to be like, no, okay, I have to be sensible, but I also have to be myself. And, draw some lines there and push those limits of who you are, what you want to represent. I think it's really a constant effort for a woman to have to do that.
Sandeep, moving on to you, I mean, you said you grew up in a family of very empowered women, so I'm sure, I mean, even if you, I don't know where you grew up, which city did you grow up in?
So I was born in Bhopal and my dad was in BHL, so...
So, I mean, this is pertaining to the whole country. I mean, you see it all the time, you know, where women are suppressed or an incident, something that you want to talk about, and especially being from an empowered house where you have women who are so powerful, so strong. I grew up with a lot of powerful, strong women around me, and some of the things that used to happen around me used to really bother me.
So for me, you know, I would like to give two examples. One was where it's a very positive example, and this happened just a month back when I was in Punjab. So my grandparents are in Punjab. So my mossy, my aunt actually, she's invested close to, let's say, 50 lakhs per granddaughter. She has two granddaughters. Both of them have gone to Canada for studies. And she was talking to them. I just went, you know, I went because it's very difficult to get time. So I'd gone to, my mother was there, so I had to go and get her back. So I entered the house and she was talking to a granddaughter in Canada. She's studying there. She's working at airport during 3 hours what she get. And they were asking, why did you send your granddaughters to, you know, Canada? You are living in a very small village in Punjab, wherein everybody is looking at, you know, marrying of the daughters after some basic education and all. She said, I'm very clear, you know, for me, because she herself was a librarian. And she is very clear in her thought that for a family evolution to happen in the right way, it's very, very important that everyone is empowered. So the two granddaughters, she's invested close to 1 crore on them. Because the study, that's the kind of amount you have to invest when the kids have to go and study in Canada. And then she was talking to them, finish your study, and then you have to get for, you know, you have to apply for your medicine course in US. So, you know, sitting in a small corner in Punjab, I could see a woman empowering, a lady who is around 75, 80, is empowering her granddaughters because she believes that, you know, she may have another 10, 15 years, but she wants the family evolution forever to happen in a very, very positive way. This is a very happy, positive example. There are examples where I could see one side of my relative, you know, really not allowing the daughters to study and then marrying them off. And then you see, you know, when you speak to your cousin sisters, when you go and talk to them, you feel, you know, okay, they were here, they lived a life, but not a kind of life.
Let's stick to happy stories. Let's stick to good stories
and
empowered stories.
In fact, you know, when we were discussing this campaign, I said, you know, this is a very happy example on this. Please, you know, do something around this. And this is all, you know. So we were looking at examples, positive example, because that's how we want to convey to the audience that, you know, we have to contribute. You know, today, talking is something, but eventually, you know, as a brand, as a citizen of the country, we have to do our bit, and that's very important.
So, Gul, are you contributing to any of these positive examples in Punjab, since you contest? It's like a political sort of question.
But actually,
you can just throw me off the stage if you want to.
There's some background to that. Around the time that we wrapped turning 30, I was at my village, which is in district Fatehgarh Sahib. Sandeep would know that. And I, you know, was talking to the local DC. We were having a conversation about what's going on. And I was shocked to find out that my district, as per the 2001 census, had the lowest sex ratio in all of India.
Wow.
And, you know, that somehow, I was 30 then. And it really shook me up because here I was with all the opportunity in the world from this village and I didn't seem to think there was anything in the world that could limit me. And yet the same district that I belonged to, Fatehgarh Sahib, had the lowest sex ratio. And that really, really got me anxious and stressed. And, you know, I figured I need to do something about it. And that's when I set up this foundation called the Colonel Shamsher Singh Foundation. It was named after my grandfather, who was then living. And because I just felt, if nothing else, I need to start doing something about it. It's called, what I call it, the guilt and privilege that one carries of accident of birth. Because if it weren't for accident of birth, I probably would have been born in a different home in the same village Mahadiya. And maybe I would have been producing a lot of girls trying to try for a boy, or maybe worse, not letting them be born. And that was the reality of that area. Fortunately for us, and not because of anything that society at large has contributed to, but another district has now beaten us, so we're no longer the lowest sex ratio in the country. But that for me was the inflection point where I decided to get down and do something about it in my own limited capacity, because I felt the accident of birth was the reason where I was not because of there being a uniform playing field. So
That's, you know, we work specifically on gender equality. We take accomplished women like Meghna, like Kalki, to talk to women in villages and try and explain to them that, look, this can also be your breadwinner. This can also be your support, because a large reason that unfortunate things like female feticide exist is because A, dowry. It's a very, very big part of the reality in the north of India. And B, because they feel when they grow old, who will take care of them? And the whole idea is to try and reach out to them. We do public-private partnership with the district health authorities to try and get this message across. It's a long message going, but yes, I think it's beginning to show results. A lot of people are now investing in education. There is a man in my village who is a daily wage mason, and I got chatting with him. There was some work going on. I was at the village again for some foundation work. And so I said, what's going on? You know, catching up in Punjabi. So he said, you know, I want to marry my daughter. And the family that we identified, because it's so rare to find an eligible bachelor in Punjab today who's not addicted to drugs. So he said, you know, I found this boy, but he wants a Scorpio. So he said, you know what? I'm going to raise that money, but I'm going to send my daughter to study with that money. So he was also looking for ways in which to send his daughter overseas, and he was trying to work things out, and there were other NGOs that stepped forward to help. But here is a man who understood the requirement that rather than raise all this money and, you know, go into debt, I'm a daily wage mason, I might as well raise this money and invest in my daughters rather than buy that Scorpio, which will, you know, wow, not achieve much.
Stories that still exist in our country. So I'm going to open it up to all you guys. Anyone wants to ask any of our panelists any questions, want to say anything about, there you go, great.
Meghna ji, aapse question ye hai ki, kya ye zyada nahi ho gaya unemployment gents ke liye badh gayi hai, jidhar jao aaj event mein dekh lijiye, 8 se 10 ladkiyan kaam kar rahi hain, gents ko bicharo kaam nahi mil raha hai, ye bhi ho gaya hai, ki kidhar bhi gallery mein jao aapko ladies hi milenge har jagah. Why injustice to men?
Men.
Especially in metropolis and all.
I don't have the figures, but I'm pretty certain that that's the case where unemployment is tilting towards men more than it is towards women. You know, I mean, and in fact, there was a recent study ki more women are getting into secondary education and colleges, but more women are dropping out of the workforce than in the last 10 years. There's been a huge jump. So from 2005 to now, more women are leaving the workforce in India. You know, so about 49% of rural women were working in 2005, and the percentage is now around 36. So, you know, I'm like I said, I'm certain that that's not the case. And anyways, I think the discussion today is about how we can sort of achieve a balance between the two. It's not really, and that's never the intention to do men versus women. You know, that's very juvenile, and we don't, that's not the idea. The idea is to look at how we can create an equal society, which is empowering for everybody. Right?
So and other thing, there is a case going, many cases going in our society, in our biradari also. So much power is given to women that on her saying, their full family is being imprisoned unnecessarily without asking.
That, actually.
Please, so, anybody can.
Sir, you're referring to Section 498 of the Indian Penal Code, which is no doubt a very very powerful piece of law. And I'm going to try and answer it as honestly as I can. There is misuse of 498, and there's no doubt about that, and it's unfortunate, but the number of people who've actually been benefited by 498 in rural areas where women are in a very, very, very poor position in the home of their husband because of exactly dowry is very disturbing. Now, is the law misused? Yes. But is it required? Also yes. I think when the lawmakers get together to make a law, and this is, of course, based on the founding principles of the modern state, when social contract of Hobbes, Locke, and Rousseau, which is what laid the foundation of the modern day state system, was the greater good. So are you trying to benefit more people or harm more people? If there is a law that actually achieves greater good with some unfortunate cases of misuse, I think it works out in balance. However, on the cases of misuse, there has been some efforts of a lot of NGOs to try and make those found guilty of misuse punishable and culpable under newer laws that are being made, which are going to be annexed to that particular law. So the punishment and culpability for those who misuse sections like the 498 should be very, very high, so other educated women, because it's the educated ones that are using it, don't use it.
Anybody else?
Hi, my question is open to all the panelists. I would like to show my concern about trivialization of hashtags and campaigns like No Means No, which comes from Bollywood and all the movies, Why Loiter, as Kalki mentioned, and all the campaigns which we see running on social media. So my question is, I'm sure my friends or people here in the hall, they know about women empowerment, everybody's talking about it, but when it comes to self-advocating the life and human rights of women or practicing it or putting it into action, so I see a gap there. And it makes no sense, you know, talking about it every time, but when you have to come to practice it, nobody is doing it. So how do we fill that gap?
Can you take that?
I think that's a general disease of the time, that social media, we talk a lot more on social media than we do in life. We feel like we've saved half the world on Facebook in half a day by saying, you know, supporting 20 causes, but actually, you know, what are we doing on the ground level? But I think that, you know, things have to start somewhere. You cannot silence a cause. Yes, hashtags, maybe, you know, maybe 70% of hashtags are just hashtags, but those 20% make a difference. There are 20% of those women who use the hashtag, or people who use the hashtag, and actually go out and do it, go out and loiter, and go out and support a cause or change laws, or even as simple as in your daily life, if you're in an office job or whatever job you're in, what do you choose? It makes a difference. Women always ask me, how can I support the cause of women? And I said, support yourself. Because, you know, if you're empowering yourself in your workplace, if you're standing up for that little misogynistic, you know, joke that's happening, you're already making a change. Yes, it might not, you know, feel like a big change, but if everybody does that every day, it is making a change. So small steps and constantly bringing up the conversation is the way forward. And of course, it's easy to be jaded by social media. I think that a lot more is said than done on social media. But it has also cut out the middleman. It has also made that people can be themselves. You know, like if I want to correct something that's misquoted about me, I can do it on my Twitter. And all in all, I think cutting out the middleman, cutting out that anyone being able to speak about what they really think is as Kul was saying, the greater good, you know?
Yeah, I'd just like to add that, I mean, you know, if you see what is the most, like I come from an advertising background, right? So what works is messages when they're repeated. There's a reason why all of these brands really repeat messages, right? And I think the same sort of idea is that if you repeat the conversation and it's constantly active and it's constantly happening around you, that's what affects you, and then you start to make small changes within your limited sphere of influence, right? So you may not see it, but it's happening with every individual person in their own limited sphere of influence. And like she said, it'll take a while where you start to see a large drastic change happening. But it's starting, and it is happening, and social media contributes to that in a big way.
You know, I'd promise that I'm not going to monopolize and talk less, but I really have to add something to that. And I'm using that, I'm removing the time frame here, because when you say you don't find changes happening immediately and people don't contribute meaningfully, if you remove the time reference frame here and look at a very larger period of time,
any change in society, anthropologically, has to start by first acknowledging the problem exists. So it starts with discussion, debate, discourse. That is when people become aware of it. Right now, a few of us may be aware of it, but each time, say, you use that hashtag, maybe somebody who wasn't aware of what was happening actually becomes aware of it. I experienced that 2 days ago when I added on to the dress like an Indian woman, otherwise you'll get PCOD thing that was going on, you know, 2 days ago. So one is that discussion, debate, dialogue is the first step towards change. The second point is that any change in society takes 3 generations. The first generation becomes aware of it. The second generation actively does something about it. And the third generation reaps benefits. So it's always a long process. Lastly, when there is dialogue, discussion, debate on a particular subject, people's awareness increases. Then over the course of time, one can look towards affirmative action, both from civil society and maybe legislative. Just to give you a small example, not too long ago in history, Raja Ram Mohan Roy was one of the social reformers who pushed the cause of trying to ban things that probably were not so unacceptable back in the day. And finally, it was the work of multiple social reformers that got Sati banned. And if you were to look at it today, there's no reason for Sati to have happened. But it took social reformers of that period, then followed by aggressive legislation. It took over 100 years before legislation was passed, that too by the British, to ban Sati. But the life cycle of any change is unfortunately that. And what social media is doing is contributing towards chatter, yes, but is also making more and more people aware of what we're talking about. And I think that's really, really important, because if the change that we want to see is going to happen 3 generations from now, which is 45 years, 15, 15, 15, it has to start now. Sorry, I really am not going to talk anymore now.
No, but it's true what you said, because it's. I think with social media, it also is going to happen much quicker, because I mean it connects so many people, puts them all together in one platform. I mean, of course, back in the day, you wrote a letter and it reached 6 months later, and then things started moving ahead. Anyway, we'll move on to you. Yeah, at the back.
So you. This whole article about girls wearing men clothing and having some disease, right?
PCOD, polycystic yeah. ovary disorder.
Yeah, so I when I read the whole thing, it was really something that I couldn't relate to one of some my friends shared it. I have studied with her in her class, so it was like, kahan se? You know, how did a principal say something like this, and who made that person a principal? I just want to understand, as a clothing brand, what do you think about that kind of comment? How do you look at that as an opportunity to kind of place yourself and say that, you know, there is nothing related to clothing, or how do you want to take it? This is to Sandeep.
Yeah. So for us, you know, when you look at the history of the brand, so when what I said, you know, for us, it's the 3 pillars, colors, knitwear, and social responsibility. So the social responsibility has been built in from day one. So when Mr. Benetton started this journey, when he was, you know, supplying garments from door to door, and when he started his journey 60 years back, somehow he felt that, you know, it's very important that as a brand, we have to be socially responsible, and socially responsible in the right way. That was very, very clear. So when you look at the history of the brand, it's always about being socially responsible in the right way. And yes, there may be things which are happening in the society, which, you know, which tend to you know, give some speculation, or, you know, on which the brand can. So we very clear, we want to be, we want to work in a way, we want to conduct ourselves in a way that we are linked to the right causes in the right way. That's the, so we don't want to, you know, just, okay, this has come up, so just grab this and, you know, look at selling your garments. No, never. Because there's a €2 billion organization globally, and it's always conducted itself in the right way. It's not looked at that, okay, this year was bad, so, you know, we're not getting the right revenue, so look at some topic and start talking about it. No, it's never been like that. So you will see our approach during last 60 years to be very, very consistent and right. We have never tried looking at anything which is, you know, like a small opportunity to grab and, you know, sell garments. No, never. So as a clothing a conglomerate or a giant, we are very, very clear, right sort of topics, which, so idea is to be, act as enabler, you know, to contribute towards society in the right way. Talk about right topics and contribute towards the evolution of society. As Gul said, you know, three generations. So today when you look at why Sati existed, you know, it's a very basic question. So a lot of such things are there. So we have to be very, very clear, and we have to keep contributing. That's the way we're looking at it.
I think so, we can keep that question for closer to Valentine's Day. Yes, ma'am.
So, what do you all think about women in startup culture? I mean, how much ever we say, you know, we've become modern, the mentality is still that, arey ladka hai to pakka business karega, achhe se karega, you know, he'll be able to handle all the pressure and everything. And when it comes to a woman, if I have my share of savings, it has to be a choice. Oh, should I spend on my fancy marriage or, you know, the startup? I mean, why do you think as women, we always have to be most, we have to have believe in ourselves, whereas men are supported so much, we have to be so self-assuring ki, theek hai, no, we'll be able to do it, we'll be able to do it. So why is it that, you know, we have to have belief in ourselves and there's no one who actually kind of does that for us, whereas when it comes to men, people are there, you know, always supporting them and saying, you know, they can do it. Just to everyone.
That is the basis of a patriarchal culture, right? So that's the whole point of when society or the culture is completely geared towards uplifting or celebrating men, and women sort of are supposed to support that journey, and they not really have a journey for themselves, right? So, you know, one of the things is, like I said, women can't do it alone. You need to work with men. I'm not saying you need to be lifted up by men, but you need to work with men, right? So, of course, it starts with being self-assured and having the confidence. And even if you don't have the confidence to kind of take that jump and take that leap of faith, but also, you know, kind of enlisting support of whoever you can to be part of your journey, right? And sometimes you have to take a leap of faith and do it just by yourself, right? But wherever you can find that support and wherever you can demand it, you should. And that's how you beat the patriarchy.
Yeah, back there.
I think you can hear me.
Yes.
This question is for our actresses on the stage, please. My question is around constructs through mainstream feature films and what the progress, if you have any insight, I know you can't speak on behalf of the entire film industry, but are there any insights or is there progress moving towards more women getting behind the camera and actually directing? I think it's nice to be able to.
I think you're asking this question also to the two most progressive sort
yes,
of
that's
directors
what.
In this
so
business.
Beyond you both, what's the movement like?
So, I don't know what's going on, but I'm only getting films offered by female directors. I've had Zoya Akhtar, Sonali Bose, I'm working with Rakhi Sandhilya right now on a film about maternity leave and women in the workforce. Who else have I worked with? My DOP was Anne Masawa on Margarita with a Straw. I don't know why, I just get, I'm attracted a lot of female directors, and you know, we are less, for sure, there are fewer female directors. So, I mean, I also know that that's maybe because of the work I do, the things I choose, people kind of find that like they have something similar to say. I feel what's really missing still in our industry is in commercial cinema is that the writing is still very hero-based. Our writing is still based on uplifting the hero. If there's a heroine in the film, she is usually uplifting and supporting the hero. And it's still the exception to have a film like Piku or Queen, where the heroine is the uplifter of the movie. And I think it would be great to see more writing where sometimes where the woman is the hero, but also sometimes where the woman is the villain, or the woman is playing very ordinary characters where we, like a driver, like me and Gula are motorbikers, and everyone finds that like shocking, a girl on a bike, but why is that not a norm? So, you know, I think representing women in cinema outside of the stereotype of the virginal beauty or, you know, the vamp, sexy item girl. I mean, seeing women in just ordinary jobs doing what they do in that is really important. And I think that begins with writing. So it's important to look out for those kind of stories.
Good, you want to add anything to that?
I think
Kalki's made a very valid point. There is the storytelling has been very one-dimensional in a lot of our films, but that's also unfortunately been the case in the West. And that is the larger patriarchal umbrella that we all fall under. There have been path-breaking films like Kahani, Piku, Turning 30, which Purabhanaba
was the protagonist, and I sat behind on a motorbike with her.
But I think, again, you know, I just want us to speak of things in a larger frame. The fact that the change is beginning now, and the fact that there is a lot of writing, which is well, not a lot, but there is a certain percentage of writing that is seeing women in the myriad roles they actually play in society, a corporate honcho, a pilot, a doctor, a driver. And I think that change has begun, and we'll only begin to see results, you know, in 15, 20 years, but or maybe faster. But it's unrealistic to expect any change in a time frame that's lesser than that. But if we keep asking these questions, if we keep having these conversations, that change will surely come. Or if we give up and say, hey, yaar, we asked all these questions, no change ever came, what the hell? Then it's not going to happen. So the idea is for us to constantly keep questioning what's happening around us, talk about it. The more we talk about it, the more change will permeate into society, not just the film industry, but the corporate world and society as a whole, because ultimately, cinema is a mirror of what's happening in society. Society begins to have equal participation of women, then you will see more participation of women in storytelling. And last but not least, the point that I want to sort of say my goodbye with is that 50% of our human resource in this country is female. Okay, 49% when it comes to India, unfortunately, but about half of India's HR resource is female. It is lying unutilized. That is the greatest argument for the whole country as a whole, men and women to together work to make sure that women become part of the workforce. Because otherwise, we're never going to beat China. So if you want to take over the dragon, you have to bring in the entire population, cajole it into the workforce, and not end up losing half the population that just doesn't get the opportunity because of whatever reason. So I think that is the biggest argument in favor of getting women into the mainstream, getting women into the workforce, empowerment, because, and men should work towards it, because after all, they also want greater GDP, they also want greater return on their stocks. So it's in everybody's interests for our country to do better, and in order for us to do better, we need to have more women participating in all walks of life, including, but not limited to cinema. I'm done. I'm sorry.
I'm going to take one last question before we end these questions from the audience.
Hi. So I think the main, most common misconception with feminism is that it's basically women ruling over men. And it's not looking at the fact that it's equality in all standpoints, where you're allowing the men to, that, like, a man can cook or a man can be a stay-at-home father if that's what he wishes to do. And for that reason, I really applaud the effort, because by putting it as united by half, you're really making a standpoint. Now, I have a couple of points. One about the talking about the socio-cultural impact that is is imposed upon us by the patriarchal society. I think it goes all the way back to the time of conception when, you know, if you're looking at, if I have a boy, just like the impact of the color pink and blue, right? I mean, you're going to be thinking what? I mean, I watched this video which said that when I was born, I was given a pink blanket. So you can look at many ways in which fashion can bring about the change that we wish to see. Because if we maybe make clothes which are more, I don't know how to put this, but typical fashion has. Yeah, fashion
stripes,
has actually done that.
Stripes, blue and pink stripes.
Yeah. Together. Yeah. Now, my main question is while we're taking, making a stand here, and I don't want to say that we are the generation that has understood that we have a problem. I want to say that we are the generation that is going to fight for the change. So I'm just going to ask that, what change do you see this campaign bringing about personally? What, taking into account all the issues that you've brought up, what changes do you want the campaign to?
So again, you know, it's being part of a journey. It's adding to a journey. It's contributing to a journey of, you know, wherein the men have to, you know, sort of take a pledge, wherein they say, you know, they will work towards giving a equal half to the women in their life. So it's your sister, it's your mother, it's your wife, it's your girlfriend, whoever is associated with you as a guy, what are you going to do? And so for example, my sister, I ensured that, you know, because I was in a family which was very well empowered, so I ensured that she does her study properly. When the decision was being taken, my mother was thinking, you know, to what extent she has to, should she do MBA or not? So I said, no, she has to do MBA. She's also currently working. She has a family, so she's working. She's managing family. She's helping her husband also in the business. So the idea here is that, you know, when we're talking about this, we want the current generation. When you look at the current generation also, for them also, again, you know, 15, 20 years or 25 years it will take for the society to feel the final impact. So we want the current generation to help us spread this message and contribute towards bringing more awareness so that, you know, talking, constantly engaging and interacting, you help people evolve around yourself, and that's how the campaign is going to help. So it's just a small contribution, I would say, but we are very proud to be associated or maybe to contribute towards the journey. That's how I'm looking at it.
So thank you Sandeep, thank you for United Colors of Benetton, United by Half. I think it's a great campaign, and thank you panelists for being here with us. I think we have all the photographers who would want us quickly coming here, very upset he's for us talking for so long. All right, so we'll do a bunch of pictures, and there's lunch, there's lovely food, please don't go hungry. Please. It's my bag now. You want to put your bag?
I'll just keep it behind you. I talk too much, it tires me out.
मेरा ये मानना है कि यूनाइटेड कलर्स ऑफ बेनेटॉन की जो कैंपेन है यूनाइटेड बाय हाफ एक बहुत ही सराहनीय अटेम्प्ट है हमारी सोसाइटी में जो कि काफ़ी पुरुष प्रधान है जिस जहाँ पे एक पुरुष प्रधान सोच प्रचलित है यहाँ पर जितनी भी हम एफर्ट्स ऐसे करें जितनी भी हम कैंपेन्स ऐसे करें बहुत काम आती हैं क्योंकि हमारे यहाँ बहुत सी ऐसी महिलाएं हैं जिन्हें अपना शेयर जो उन्हें मिलना चाहिए जो उनके अधिकार हैं जो उन्हें मिलने चाहिए मिलते नहीं हैं तो मैं बहुत खुश हूँ आई एम वेरी वेरी हैप्पी टू सपोर्ट द यूनाइटेड कलर्स ऑफ बेनेटॉन यूनाइटेड बाय हाफ कैंपेन आई थिंक इट्स अ फैंटास्टिक कैंपेन एंड आई कंग्रेचुलेट देम फॉर हैविंग टेकन दिस स्टेप टुवर्ड्स कॉर्पोरेट रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी टू पुश समथिंग विच इज सो इम्पॉर्टेंट इन द सोसाइटी लाइक आवर्स
कहीं ना कहीं देश में आज भी महिला और पुरुष में काफी फर्क देखा जाता है कभी दिखाया जाता है कि यार ये महिला कैसी है ये पुरुष है तो पहले से प्रशिक्षण हैज बीन डन लेकिन इस तरीके से आप इसको इस क्षेत्र में किस तरीके से देखते हैं
मेरा ये मानना है कि अगर हमें समाज में कोई भी बदलाव लेकर आना है तो उसके लिए पहले बातचीत करनी होगी उस मुद्दे पर शायद वाद होगा विवाद होगी उसके बाद ही कोई तब्दीली आएगी और इस बात में कोई शक नहीं है कि हमारे यहाँ जो आधी जनसंख्या है हमारी जो महिलाओं की की गिनती है अगर वहाँ से उस दृष्टिकोण से देखा जाए तो शायद बहुत सी ऐसी महिलाएं हैं जिन्हें अगले क्षण वो क्या करेंगी ये भी चुनने का हक नहीं है तो बाकी दूसरे बड़े बड़े हकों की बात करें तो शायद लंबी बात है पर बेसिक किस कहाँ जाना है कितना पढ़ना है किससे शादी करनी है ये भी उन्हें अधिकार नहीं है चुनने का तो मेरा ये मानना है कि हम जितनी भी कैंपेन्स ऐसे करें ये उस मुद्दे को और उछालेंगी और जैसे जैसे ये मुद्दा और उछलेगा तो ही आने वाले सालों में हमें तब्दीली दिखाई देगी
टॉक अबाउट द वुमेन एम्पावर डोंट यू थिंक द बॉलीवुड मूवीज हैज प्लेड अ ग्रेटर रोल टू स्प्रेड ऑल मैसेज टू ऑल द गर्ल इन द मुंबई एंड ऑल द कंट्री
आई थिंक बॉलीवुड इज अ वेरी वेरी पावरफुल मीडियम इट हैज द पोटेंशियल टू propagate ideas to push change while entertaining the audience. And I think if that can be done with the clear intent of entertaining first and then putting together a powerful message, whatever that message may be, I think we will see change come in society sooner rather than later.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
वैसे मैं यहाँ पे सिर्फ एक एक मॉडरेटर के रोल प्ले कर रहा हूँ. मैं स्टेज पे हमारे जो पैनलिस्ट थे, बड़े इंटरेस्टिंग पैनलिस्ट थे, गुलपना को लेके, सॉरी कैमरा लुक मैं बोल रहा हूँ. मैं सोचा मैं बोल रहा हूँ कैमरा रोलिंग तो बातें चालू कर दिए, फिर से लूँगा. वैसे इस कैंपेन के साथ, इस इवेंट के साथ मैं सिर्फ एक मॉडरेटर के एक रोल निभा रहा हूँ. यहाँ पे हमारे पैनलिस्ट बहुत ही इंटरेस्टिंग थे, जैसे कि मेघना जो स्कूप की एक स्ट्रैटेजिस्ट है, फिर गुलपनाग जो एक एक्सट्रीमली आई मीन ग्रेट एक्टर, आल्सो वेरी प्रोमिनेंट पॉलिटिशियन नाउ. मेरे लिए गुल तो एक बाइक राइडर हमेशा रहेगी, शी राइड्स अ बाइक आल्सो एंड आल्सो फ्लाइज अ प्लेन. कल्कि केकला जो एक्चुअली इस कैंपेन की फेस है, उनकी फ़ोटो भी वहाँ लगी है. आई थिंक शी इज़ एन इंटरेस्टिंग पैनलिस्ट. एंड ऑफकोर्स संदीप चुग जो इस कंपनी के MD है, आई थिंक वो पैनलिस्ट है, वो अच्छी तरह से जुड़े हैं. लेकिन इनकी जो आइडियाज़ हैं, इनकी कैंपेन के जो आइडियाज़ हैं, मैं वाकिफ हूँ उससे. एंड आई थिंक आई स्टैंड बाय बिलीविंग दैट वुमेन एंड मैन शुड बी ट्रीटेड इक्वली एंड वी शुड बी यूनाइटेड हाफ वे थ्रू.
ओके, पूरा जाना चाहूँगा जिस तरीके से आज के टाइम में देश इतना आगे निकलने के बावजूद भी अभी वुमेंस और मेंस में काफ़ी फ़र्क किया जाता है, इस पर आप क्या कहना
चाहेंगे? इंडिया में
मेरे ख्याल से हमारे देश में पॉपुलेशन इतना बड़ा है, अगर एक आइडिया, जैसे कि गुल ने स्टेज में भी पॉइंट आउट किया था कि 3 जनरेशन लगते कि एक आइडिया को एक्चुअली इम्प्लाई होने में और एक बड़ा सा चेंज लाने के लिए. और हमारे देश में ज़्यादातर क्योंकि हम इतना अपना पॉपुलेशन जो इतना बड़ा है, तो एक आइडिया कहीं जर्म होता है, एक कोने में कहीं कोई एक आइडिया दे देता है और उस आइडिया को फैलने में थोड़ा वक्त लग जाता है. तो अब फ़िलहाल इस टाइप की चीज़ें कई सालों से डिस्कशन हो रही है. इसी टॉपिक में वुमेन एम्पावरमेंट में देखा जाए, इतना सप्रेशन हो चुका है इन द पास्ट की एक एक चीज़ को उठा के काम शुरू हुआ है. कुछ चीज़ सॉल्व हुए, कुछ चीज़ अभी भी सॉल्व होने बाकी है. तो मेरे ख्याल से टाइम लगेगा, लेकिन बदलाव आ रहा है, तेज़ गति से आ रही है. आई थिंक कुछ सालों में सोचता हूँ कि अपने देश को सचमुच एक प्रोग्रेसिव देश सोचने के लिए सोच सकेंगे जब वुमेन एंड मैन विल बी ट्रीटेड इक्वली, जैसे कोई डिवाइड नहीं होगा दोनों के बीच में.
वुमेन पर भी बात करें तो बॉलीवुड की हीरोइन सोनाक्षी सिन्हा दबंगल कहलाई जाती है, जो बहुत अच्छी अच्छी मूवी करके इंडिया की सारी लड़कियों को अच्छा मैसेज दी है. हाल ही में आप उनके साथ शूटिंग कर रहे हैं नूर पिक्चर, तो व्हाट्स द स्टेटस ऑफ द मूवी और कैसा रहा एक्सपीरियंस फर्स्ट टाइम सोनाक्षी सिन्हा?
नूर के बारे में मैं ज़्यादा नहीं बोलूँगा, इतना ही. आपके जो सवाल पहला सवाल था कि पिक्चर कहाँ तक पहुँची है, वेल शूटिंग कंप्लीट हो गई है और बहुत जल्द आपको बहुत इन्फॉर्मेशन मिलेगा क्योंकि 21 अप्रैल को रिलीज़ भी है. तो बहुत अनाउंसमेंट्स होंगे, बहुत पार्टीज़ होंगे, बहुत इन्फॉर्मेशन मिलेगा आपको फिल्म के बारे में. बड़ी अच्छी फिल्म. सोनाक्षी इज़ ग्रेट, आई थिंक शी इज़ अ सुपर्ब लीडिंग लेडी. कुछ डिस्कशन हुआ था भी आज स्टेज पे कि बहुत से पिक्चर नहीं बनते जहाँ पे फीमेल लीड्स पे लिखा जाता है स्टोरी, और नूर ऐसी फिल्म है जहाँ पे नूर की जो कैरेक्टर है इज़ अ वेरी स्ट्रॉन्ग एंड एम्बिशियस गर्ल, एंड सोनाक्षी इज़ सुपर्ब एज नूर. और मेरा एक छोटा सा किरदार है, आप देखेंगे तो पता लगेगा.
सो जैसे कि वैलेंटाइन भी आ रहा है, सो व्हाट्स योर वैलेंटाइन प्लान?
माय वैलेंटाइन प्लान्स इज वेल, मुझे नहीं लगता कि एक दिन है कि जहाँ पे आप अपने जो भी लव्ड वंस है को बोलना चाहिए कि आई लव यू, हर दिन बोलना चाहिए. तो फिलहाल मेरे वैलेंटाइन प्लान ये कि मैं अफ्रीका जा रहा हूँ और उसके येलो फीवर का जो शॉट का अपॉइंटमेंट मिला है मुझे, वो 14 तारीख को है, तो सुबह को मैं येलो फीवर शॉट ले रहा हूँ. थैंक यू.
About the campaign?
Yeah,
so I'm here for United by Half, which is a campaign by United Colors of Benetton on women empowerment. And the whole idea of United by Half is the idea that women are claiming their half. So we don't want to be better than men, we don't want more than men, but we want to be equal to men. And I think it's a very important campaign. I think it's also very relevant today. It's a global conversation. And it means that men and women need to work together rather than separate from each other.
کل کس طریقے سے دیکھتے ہیں آپ جو ڈفرینس کو میل اور فیمیل کے, جس طریقے سے آج کے ٹائم میں کیا جاتا ہے کہ ہمیشہ وومنس کو ایک میل سے چھوٹا مارا جاتا ہے, چھوٹا کہا جاتا ہے جیسے گاؤں ایریا میں یا کسی بھی ایریا میں, تو آپ کس آپ کیا کہنا چاہیں گے سر؟
ایک لڑکی ہے تو اس کو پنک ہی پہننا چاہیے اور ایک لڑکا ہے تو
وہ اسٹیریوٹائپنگ بہت ہے, ایبسلیوٹلی میل اور فیمیل جینڈر اسٹیریوٹائپنگ بہت ہے. اور کیا ہوتا ہے کہ جب فیمیلس کو اسٹیریوٹائپ کرتے ہیں, وہ بولتے ہیں کہ لڑکی کو ایسے کام نہیں کر سکتی ہے, وہ موٹر بائک نہیں رائڈ کر سکتی ہے, ایسے جب ہم کہتے ہیں وہ تو وہ آٹومیٹکلی میل اسٹیریوٹائپنگ بھی ہوتا ہے کہ لڑکا مرد ہونا چاہیے, ماچو ہونا چاہیے, اس کو مطلب رونا نہیں چاہیے. اور یہ لمیٹیشنس ہو جاتا ہے سوسائٹی میں, کیوں ایک لڑکی فٹ بال نہیں کھیل سکتی, کیوں ایک لڑکا آرٹسٹ نہیں بن سکتا ہے. تو آئی تھنک اٹس ویری امپورٹنٹ کہ یہ بدل سکتے ہیں ہم, اینڈ آئی تھنک وہ کانورسیشنس ہو رہے ہیں, دھیرے دھیرے بدل رہے ہیں اور لوگوں سوچ رہے ہیں اس کے بارے میں. تو کبھی ایک فلم ہوتا ہے جیسے پیکو, جہاں پہ دیپیکا پادوکون از دا مین ہیرو آف دا فلم, وہ تو ہیرو ہے. کوئی آفن جب میں کوئی فلم کر رہی ہوں, لوگ مجھے پوچھتے ہیں ہیرو کون ہے فلم میں, تو لائک مارگریٹا ود اے سٹرا میں میں بولتی ہوں میں ہی ہیرو ہوں. تو وہ بہت ضروری ہے کہ فیمیل ہیروئنس بھی ہے, میل ہیروز بھی ہے, کہ ہم ایکول ہے, ہم سب انسان ہیں پہلے, اس کے بعد ہم ایک میل یا لڑکا یا لڑکی ہے, لیکن پہلے ہم انسان ہیں. فاکس ٹریولر پہ ایک بائک شو کیا تھا میرے پاپا کے ساتھ, اور وہ بھی ایک جینڈر اسٹیریوٹائپ بریک کیا ہم نے, کیونکہ لوگ سوچتے ہیں کہ لڑکی بائک نہیں بائک پہ نہیں جاتی ہے. اینڈ اٹ واز تھرو نارتھ ایسٹ, وہ بھی کیونکہ ہم زیادہ نارتھ ایسٹ کو ایکسپلور نہیں کرتے ہیں میرے حساب سے, اور وہ بہت خوبصورت جگہ ہے, تو ہم نے آسام, اروناچل پردیش اور میگھالیہ میں ٹریول کیا تھا. ویلنٹائن پلانس میں شوٹ کر رہی ہوں گوا میں فار مائی ویب سیریز اسموک, تو مجھے پتہ نہیں, شاید ایک سیکرٹ لور مجھے اچھا کچھ بھیج دے گا, پتہ نہیں کیا ہوگا, اور شاید میں بھیج سکتی ہوں کسی کو سیکرٹلی, میں سیکرٹلی کروں گی. تھینک یو.